Oh, good morning, and thank you for having me. I'm about 16 standard deviations outside anything that probably interests you in the room. Not only because I'm a seismologist, but there are rather few of us here, although it is an important ingredient in ICTP, but also because I'm going to talk about people and their failings. So, what is the point of seismology? Many people immediately ask the first question, can you predict earthquakes? No. Sorry, can't do that. Despite the Italian government's insistence that they should be able to do that, we can't do it. But I have listed here four failings, and although some of them are in fact success stories, I consider them to be failings. We can indicate precisely within a few seconds of it happening when your house will fall down. This, of course, is not much use unless you are ready to leap out of the room and outside or whatever you want to do. The other failing, which is a success story is in a way, is that we can estimate the death toll in near the epicenter within about 30 minutes of an earthquake happening anywhere in the world. Now, you might think, well, what is he talking about, predicting the death toll? The problem is that when an earthquake happens, people in the epicenter have no idea what hit them. Some of them are dead, of course. Many of them are injured. But the local authorities will try to mobilize themselves to come to the rescue of the survivors. And it is not known in the epicenter exactly what happened. And it's very important that information about the number of dead, the number of injured, and perhaps the economic costs involved are issued immediately. These facts are only established a few weeks after the earthquake has happened, usually. And then our last failing is the one I'm going to talk about today, really, is that we can almost guarantee that 25,000 people a year will die in earthquakes in the next decade. And some of those people might be you.
Thank you.
So just a quick mention of what we might consider to be successes. When a thunderstorm is near you, you see the lightning, and you know the thunder is on its way. You start counting in seconds, the thunder arrives. We can do the same thing for earthquakes. We can locate the earthquake within a couple of seconds of it occurring, as long as there are three nearby seismometers, and we can predict from the magnitude and its location, the shaking everywhere within a few seconds in a computer, and broadcast that at the speed of light to a screen nearby. And as you can see, there is a picture here of one such prediction. Oh dear, I've switched it off. Where's the point of which one? The top one. Okay, great, thank you. So here's a 7-second warning, 2, 3, and it hits you. It's not much use. On the other hand, for some larger earthquakes, you might have a 70-second warning, which is enough time to think, is this machine really working? Or should I get out, or should I get under the desk? And so this is kind of useful, but it's not particularly a success story because we haven't really given you much warning. And here's an example of the 30-minute prediction of deaths in an earthquake. This is one by WAPMA, Max Weiss. The USGS can do the same. This is the Wenchuan earthquake a few years ago. The prediction was that between 40 and 100,000 people had died in this earthquake. What actually was known a few weeks after the earthquake was the number was 85,000. And this is, it takes 25 minutes to do this calculation because the seismic waves from a global earthquake take 23 minutes to actually get through to the furthest parts of the Earth. Now, the last failure is the one I'm going to talk about. It's to do with people and cities. I'm showing on the left the growth of cities in the last 1,000 years, from 1000 AD to 1600 AD. And you can see city sizes are more or less the same. They don't grow very much. I've indicated the largest city in each century. And the reason is that in pre-medieval times, cities were a place where rural populations went to die. They simply went to the city, they got ill, and they died before they had many children. And the children themselves died. And that kept our population in check. What's happened in the last 200 years is that we've invented medicine, and now people can live in cities. And I can almost guarantee that everybody in the audience lives in a city, because we now live in a an urban world. The dominant population in cities exceeded the rural population in about 2003. So here is the date of that transition, and you can see that cities in the industrial nations have been slowly growing. In fact, some have been decreasing in size, like New York. But cities in the developing nations have been increasing exponentially. This is a log scale. And as a result, there was a huge population explosion of these cities. This gray line is the well-known exponential growth in population that started in about 1950s. Now, on this graph is, I'm introducing the global fatality death toll. And you can see that also increases as we get more people on this planet. So the question one can ask is it simply keeping up with the population? As a reminder, these are large numbers, 8 million deaths from earthquakes, 5 million in the last 500 years. If we look in the last century, and this is an important century because at the beginning of this century, we discovered that it was buildings that killed people, not earthquakes. Okay? And we discovered how to build cities that could, in fact, survive earthquakes. The red trace is the count, and you can see that in the last 15 years, we've killed more people from earthquakes than ever in our entire history. Okay? This isn't the only exponential thing that is related to population, but it's the one that interests me. Now, if you normalize that to world populations, you find the black curve actually will tell you that it's more or less stayed the same. Now, what's wrong with that picture is that we should be doing better. We should be saving many people's lives because we understand what earthquakes do. In fact, ironically, in Italy, it's where we first learned how to do that. Robert Mallet studied an earthquake in 1857, which occurred just south of us. And he basically documented very, very clearly that earthquakes don't kill people, buildings do. In fact, he has this wonderful quote, "The eye is bewildered by a city become an heap," which is a quote from the Bible, of course. Okay, so earthquakes. We've had some terrible earthquakes in the last century. I'm not going to dwell on them. You will recall them. A lot of them have occurred in the last 15 years. They kill 20,000 to 100,000 people. And they all look the same. That's why I'm not going to bother to talk about them much. But they are tragedies beyond belief. Haiti with 85,000 dead. I'm afraid they've exaggerated the actual numbers. But it leads to a plot like this, which, thanks to this must be a stupid PC, you can't see what those earthquakes are, but essentially it's divided into two types of countries, wealthy nations that lose a lot of money when an earthquake happens. In other words, they're earthquake resistant, but there's a lot of money goes into repairing infrastructure like damaged plaster. And the poor nations, where earthquakes result in large numbers of deaths. And I'll just read the numbers since you can't actually see them. These is billions of US dollars, $100 billion. The most expensive thus far was, of course, the Turku earthquake a few years ago. And the Kashmir earthquake and the Wenchuan earthquake and so on have killed large numbers of people in other parts of the world. So let's look where this occurs. This is a global map of deaths in the last 1,000 years. And the thing to notice is that 85% of all those deaths have occurred in this belt over here. And that belt is the point, this the southern edge of what we call the Eurasian Plate. And the importance about this belt of earthquakes is that it is a collision zone, the Alpine, Himalayan, Indonesian collision zone. And in fact, all the plates beneath it are converging towards it, the Pacific from the east and the Atlantic from the west, and various other locations. Now, how have seismologists dealt with this problem? Esoterically, we have studied everything we know about earthquakes by looking very carefully. This is dead. Yes, thanks. Looking very carefully at the history of earthquakes, the details of strain in epicentral regions, and we characterize this as seismic hazards. That's the science of seismology. Engineers use our calculations and construct buildings based on the accelerations that are known to, or buildings will experience when they go up, and they get a lot of money from society. That money goes mostly into civic structures. I've listed them there, and you know all this. The problem is that earthquakes don't care at all about this stuff. If you, okay, we don't want dams collapsing, we don't want power stations collapsing. In fact, they don't. They are very well built by engineers. The problem is we live in buildings that fall down, and those buildings are the ones that are not being focused on by the seismological community. In other words, there are 500 million vulnerable dwelling units on our planet. So let's look specifically at which countries are involved. When you look at this on a plot, this is a plot of the number of earthquakes with more than 3,000 people killed, and you can see there are some countries with multiple occurrences of these tragedies. In fact, more than 20 in Turkey, Italy, Japan, Iran, and China. We're in one of those countries. It's really weird, but Italy has had a terrible record of fatalities in the past century. So now let's look at a possible reason why this is. I'm going to talk about corruption briefly. These are numbers, these are not opinions, these are numbers quantified as best possible by Transparency International. Corruption in the building industry is the worst in any public sector in the world. It's more corrupt than in the military and in any other system you might expect. And it takes several, it's manifested in many ways, mainly in ways to cover up doing a bad job on constructing a building. Now, if you plot on a worldwide scale the relationship of corruption in this vertical axis, 10 is no, not at all corrupt, and you can see New Zealand, Finland, and Denmark up here, and less than 2 is very corrupt, and there are some countries down here I won't mention by name. I've been asked not to mention names, and I'm sure that many of you can recognize your country and probably feel ashamed of its position. I do. I'm from the US and the UK, and we're not at the top. We are, to some degree, corrupt, of course, but we're not the worst. And if you plot this thing, you can see immediately that we have a relationship between corruption and income. And that one can fit to a least squares regression curve, and one can see that some countries are less corrupt than expected for their given income level, and some are more corrupt. And if we now plot earthquakes on a three-dimensional scale, here is corruption from 2 to 10, with the least corrupt countries at one end, and here is this, are you more corrupt than you should be given your income, or less corrupt at the bottom, and you find that earthquakes, killer earthquakes, occur in countries that are more corrupt than they should be given their income level. So this is a remarkable relationship. And what can we do about it? Well, it turns out that wealthy nations have strong buildings. Poor nations have a combination of ignorance, corruption, and weak buildings. And they follow that same belt where most of the earthquakes occur. So it's not a big surprise. Is there a fix? Education. There are societal factors built into each one of us that want to take shortcuts. It's not who is to blame, but we are to blame. We are people. If we're driving down a road late at night and there's a speed limit and we're in a hurry, we have no qualms about breaking the speed limit because we will not be caught out. And that happens in the building industry all the time because there is no responsibility to a contractor in putting up a building. So I regard this as a weak link in science and its communication to society to whom we are responsible. I think the fix is education, and ICTP is in fact in a remarkable position to do something about this. And so let me try to redress this grim picture I've been painting for you. We're not in the world of declining oil. We're in the world of construction. Because the world population is still doubling, we are building more buildings now than we've ever built before. Let's build them right. Thank you.
Well, let's thank the both speakers for these stimulating talks. I was just wondering, if the organizers, if we can just have one question from each of the speakers. Yes, sir.
There is a side consequence of earthquake, tsunami. We have seen in Japan how a tsunami can be terrible. How are you doing about predicting the risk of tsunami versus predicting earthquakes? Because it's a consequence of earthquake, right, in a sense.
Yeah, I think we're very good at predicting tsunami because we can make the measurements in the epicentral region and predict the arrival on the opposite side of the ocean with a warning of 2 or 3 hours. In fact, a young seismologist, a 25-year-old seismologist, sent me an email and said, "My God, a magnitude 9 earthquake has just occurred in the Andaman region. Surely there will be a tsunami." And he called up various people. There was no mechanism there to accept that warning. The problem is you can't predict the tsunami arrival so well at the local coastline. In fact, there was a 4 or 5 minute warning in Japan. That was good. But in some locations, the tsunami is the first warning of the tsunami, and that is certainly the case here in the Mediterranean. The first warning will be the shaking from the earthquake. That is the moment you head for high ground.
Just one more question, and then we'll have to go back. Yes.
It is just, but we know that computing is exact. You introduced the idea of inexact computing. Could you tell more, if possible?
Well, as I say, increasingly the metric which is going to be important is not just the number of calculations you can do per second, but also how many watts of energy. So new metrics in computing actually involve what are called flops per watt. This is becoming a crucial quantity. Now, the question is, when we have in my case, climate, we have essentially a turbulent fluid with a spectrum of scales nonlinearly coupled together. If we focus on this energy metric, we can do significantly more calculations, if you like, per second, by relaxing this notion of precise bit reproducibility, and by relaxing this. If you like, default that we always represent variables by double precision floating point numbers. So with a given energy resource, it allows us actually to probe into the much smaller scales, and in particular to start to get down to these cloud scales. Now, the question is, this could well lead to a much more precise paradoxical answer in terms of what global warming we can expect in the future. Now, I suspect this has traction beyond just pure climate.
Yeah, I think we must move on. Let's again thank the both speakers.
We have a question.